Hello and welcome to the fourth video in the Loeb series, Nature and Art. My name is Magdalena. I work as a docent at the Art Center, and today I am so excited to be talking a little bit about watercolor and landscape, but overall just what it means to represent and identify the natural world throughout art history. We are incredibly lucky here at the Loeb to have a beautiful collection of Hudson River School landscape paintings made by artists like Frederick Church, Jasper Cropsey, and Sanford Gifford from the mid-19th century. These artists work primarily in the medium of oil on canvas to both celebrate American scenery and ultimately to help change perceptions of the artistic and spiritual elements of landscape altogether. However, it's significant to note that they often achieve this through physically entering the landscapes and documenting what they found there using smaller canvases or even sketchbooks, sometimes with oil paint, but often watercolor. They would then go back to their studios and translate what they found onto a larger canvas. We see an example of this working directly from nature in the painting Artist Sketching at Greenwood Lake by Jasper Cropsey, where this small artist figure's back is turned to us as he faces towards this beautiful scene of nature before him. However, I want to show a landscape that might be a little more familiar to us, titled View of Vassar College from Sunset Hill. Now this piece is exciting for a number of reasons, not the least of which is that it's a scene we know. But I want to point out that this piece was painted in the 19th century by Henry Van Ingen, and unlike the works I just showed you, this one's a watercolor study. Now we might ask ourselves what the advantages are of watercolor opposed to a medium like oil. On one hand, watercolor lends itself very well to portability. It's easily transportable and dries very quickly, and thus is a beautiful medium for this kind of painting. We can even imagine our artist sitting at the top of Sunset Hill, completing this study in one or two sittings. But we should also consider how watercolor works aesthetically and within the composition here. Van Ingen greets us first with a gentle, winding path that brings us past the light green trees in the foreground, and then finally to this darker, forested area. Here we're introduced to the subtle form of Vassar's main building. In these forms, he's created an interesting conversation between the natural forms of the trees as well as the blue, rolling hues of the mountains behind. It's almost as if we have to walk into this piece to fully discover something that the artist's hidden for us to find. Then, on purely technical levels, we might observe the washy, light hues that run throughout the piece. And although we're looking at only a digital photograph of the painting, we can still see the distinction between these washes of color in the sky and in the grass, opposed to where the artist has really gone in to define the markation of the trees through intentional brushstroke, creating this kind of tension between dark areas of dark that are built up through browns and blues and even some red, versus these much paler, thin washes of neutral color. Along this line, I want to highlight watercolor's ability to capture some of the other topics you might have heard discussed in earlier videos, such as the transience and ephemerality of the natural world. The loose, watery nature of this medium allows for us to even more clearly imagine how these trees might be growing before our very eyes, the skies perhaps on the brink of a shift, and even to notice the tinges of reddening leaves around the trees. These altogether continuously serve as things we can look for in landscape painting, both watercolor or otherwise. But to speak more to the advantages of watercolor as a medium, I want to bring us to the study of pine tree done in the early 20th century by John Marin. Now, unlike our previous artist, Marin was an artist that was studying the developing modernity of the city, and thus, his work was much more stylized and often expressionistic, centering and emphasizing the medium of painting and often verging on abstraction in doing so. In Pine Tree, we're looking at a very different kind of landscape, one that's maybe not so much focused on a traditional mode of representation. Instead, we see this very loose, expressive brushstroke. It's almost as if we can see the artist's hand moving over the paper, scuffling in these darker greens and reds, letting the purple bleed into squiggly pools of water on the page. This emphasis is also achieved just by the sheer amount of page that he's left visible, all this white space, which allows the forms to vibrate against each other in a harmonious kind of tension, one that also emphasizes the distinctions of the medium itself. It's as if the process of sitting down to visually observe what's in front of the artist has been made all the more immediate and visible to the viewer through these techniques. Although we might not as easily be able to identify exactly where this was painted, or what species of plant we're looking at, or even if these shapes are defining a form or shadow, Marin is nevertheless really giving us an exciting, immediate experience. We encounter color and shape as if they're dancing together here, as if they're alive and breathing. Although the use of watercolor for this work may not have shown us exactly what the scene may have looked like, so to say, it nevertheless gives us a sensorial experience of the natural world, one that's centered on feeling and experience. Lastly, in stark contrast, I want to bring us to a piece that centers specifically on identification in the natural world. This print, Tulipa Persica, Tulipa Candia, was completed in the early 17th century by Crispin de Passa the Younger. As we can see here, this artist brings us into the immediacy of the natural world, less so through the expressive technique that watercolor allows for, and instead through an exact focus study of botanical life. Nevertheless, we're still greeted with a similar kind of landscape here. Just as our previous artists curiously went out into the natural world to identify and represent what they found there, artists as well often brought the natural world into theirs in smaller specimens. In fact, this work exists within the context of the book Hortus Floridus. During this period, tulips were introduced to Western Europe from Turkey and quickly became all the rage. Passet created these engravings from drawings he made from live specimens, those which were found in the collections of various tulip enthusiasts, that with the intention that they would be then colored in by the owners of the book themselves. Through this passage of observation, identification, and reproduction, the experiencing of the natural world, and specifically the tulip, moved through several immediate encounters. Although these three pieces are very different in style, context, and even the way in which their mediums are used, they nevertheless all show us powerful immediate encounters between the artist and the natural world. Regardless of what medium you're using, just by observing, identifying, and replicating nature, you're participating in a long, wonderful history of art. Thank you for watching, and go explore.